It's a sparse version. It's a sparse counting result because it holds true for all m bigger than much bigger than root n. Yeah. So if m were a constant times n, it would be a counted version of a version of thermality.
So
Gaussian
equals
a counting version. Because we're counting the KAP free sets. It's a bound on the number of sets. So we're counting. Sorry? Yeah, when I say counting version, I just mean we're counting the sets. It's a result that counts something. It gives a bound on the number of them, that's all. And we showed last time that the counting version implies the sparse random version, right? Which was a very easy argument using Markov's inequality. Okay. And at the very end, last time I stated a container version of sparse Samaredi, which is going to imply the counting version, which said something like there exists a collection C of subsets of N such that a for every KAP free set I is a subset of C for some C and C. So this family forms a cover of all independent sets, of all KAP free sets. And B, the size of C is at most yeah, do I really want to use C? I probably don't want to use C because even though they're containers, because I'm using C everywhere else for a large constant. So for every some X and C, whatever. And C is at most N choose some large constant times N. Sorry. No one picked up on the fact that I was mixing two things. These are all results for k equals 3. Sorry, I put the wrong bounds for everything. So, apologies for that. N to the 1 over k minus 1. And n to the 1 minus 1 over k minus 1. Sorry. So when k equals 3, it's root n. Okay? Yep. Okay. Into 1 minus 1 over k minus 1. Okay. And the container version implies the counting version. Did I do this correctly?
Do any of the arrows go
in? No. Well, I mean, in the sense that all the theorems are true,
yes.
But but no, it doesn't follow easily, no.
Okay.
No, these are weakenings of the result. So this is, I guess, a structural version of the counting version. So how does container version imply counting? Well, that's very easy. Right. So every KAP free set is contained in one of these containers. So let's just sum over all containers all of the subsets. Okay. Number of KAP free M sets is at most, by the container version, sum over C, X in C. Ah. Yes, I did forget something crucial. Yep. Size of X is at most delta N for all X in C. Right. So you can cover it with a small number of small sets. Size of X, choose M. It's okay. This is at most N choose C, N to the 1 minus 1 over K minus 1, delta N, choose M, which is at most 2 delta N choose M, if M is much, much bigger than this guy, C and K minus 1. So, possibly the fact I'm using the same C every time when they're different constants is confusing, but although these things are getting weaker, the constant that we require is getting bigger. But yes, M should be much bigger than this, and also as a function of delta. So this is, M should be bigger than some C prime that depends on C and delta times N to the 1 minus 1 over K minus 1. That makes sense. This is the, if you like, C prime and C double prime. Make sense? So all of these constants depend on each other, and you have to keep track of them. But you always have this, in whichever theorem you're trying to prove, you have a constant you're allowed to make as big as you like. So you can allow, that constant can depend on all of the other constants. Make it huge, and you win.
So,
okay. Ces lignes dépendent de ces e delta. So C prime is a function of C and delta. Okay. So our aim is to prove this container version. If we prove the container version, we get everything. And we're going to do it using this key lemma. So I'm probably going to put it this key lemma lots more times. But let me try and state it in a slightly simpler way than I did last time. Uh, So let H be a k-uniform hypergraph such that delta L of H is at most C times P to the L minus 1 times E of H over V of H for all L between 1 and K. So, does everyone remember the definitions of delta L?
No.
So let me write it here. Delta L of H is the maximum degree in H of a set T such that the size of T is L. And what's this thing? It's just the number of edges containing T. K uniform means every edge has exactly k vertices. And the particular hypergraph we're going to think of is the one which encodes k term APs in 1 up to n. So, cada aresta desse hipergrafo é exatamente KPA. In um ateni. Então, tem cada elementos que são os elementos desse progressão matemática.
O caso
significa isso? Isso não é nada, significa...
Mas no caso, quando o senhor fala codificar, é porque está dizendo que a aresta é um conjunto tal?
Está dizendo que... Está dizendo somente que cada aresta é... progressão matemática de manhã cá. Que as restas são exatamente as progressões matemáticas. Ok. So note that when L equals 1, this is just saying that the maximum degree is within a constant factor of the average degree. Right? This guy is basically the average degree. And L is 1, it's just C times the average degree. So it's a uniformity condition, saying that you don't have too many edges clustered in a small area. But it's saying more than that, it's saying that also not only is every degree of a vertex roughly what it should be, but every degree of a pair of vertices is, well, not necessarily roughly what it should be, but it goes down a decent amount. So it's saying something like your hypergraph isn't a blow up. Of a smaller of a graph, say. Okay, so it's very easy to construct examples of hypergraphs where the conclusion fails just by taking blow-ups of things. And then if your 2 degree is basically the same as your 1 degree, your p has to be 1. First, if you take a vertex of maximum degree, so take a graph, and then I don't know what we're going to do. So for every edge of this, we blow up vertices into 2 parts, and then we can take a triple. This is the form vertex, vertex, vertex. And then you have way too much correlation between your pairs of vertices. Does that make any sense? No. Okay. Well, maybe don't worry about it. Okay, so it's some kind of uniformity condition. Okay, so what does it tell you then? For every independent set of H, there exist sets S, depending on I, and A, depending on S, such that what? S is small, so most constant times P times, let's say, on N vertices. Let's say capital N vertices.
What is P?
Right. For some P. So P is an arbitrary number between 0 and 1. And if this condition holds for a particular P, then we get a particular conclusion, which is that the size of S is at most a constant times P times N. So. P is always actually going to be end up being the probability in our, yeah, so the P that we can prove it for will end up being exactly this P here, which is why we call it P. But at the moment, it's just some arbitrary fixed number. It can depend on N. It can depend on H.
Right? We can.
Yes. It does subtly, because this is in fact C times P times N. For the P we're going to take. The lower part. So we are going to set P equals N to the minus 1 over K minus 1. Okay? That's the value that it will take in this particular application. And H equals the collection of K-term APs in N. Okay? In this application. Today. But the lemma is more general. S is small, and I contains S, which is contained in A union S. Okay. Bound on A2, yeah. Size of A is at most 1 minus delta times N. I'm going to put that underneath the size. So for the moment, I'm going to do the actual size of A. You're right, this is going to come via a bound on the number of edges in A. And so there's an even more general version of this that I'm not stating yet. But yes. Yeah. Okay. So what happened?
Well,
yep.
The lemma is then for K units and I
A k plus 1 term AP is not a k term AP, though it contains two of them.
Yeah.
So if we forbid all k term APs, then we've forbidden all k plus 1 term APs as well.
Yes.
So we're looking at independent sets in this hypergraph.
Yes.
Right. So what's the problem?
It's not a problem.
Okay. You could.
And that wouldn't change what we forbid, I think. If
you did it that way, fine. Yeah.
But, for example, in the lemma, is it very important that it's actually K uniform? And if we took this bigger one, specific bigger one.
Yes. The lemma we're definitely only going to prove for K uniform hypergraphs. I'm not saying one couldn't prove a corresponding lemma for hypergraphs with different sized edges.
K and above.
If you allow your edges to be unbounded. Yeah, so I don't know. I mean, perhaps when we go through the proof, then you can. It's yeah. I mean, if we want to make our hypergraph bigger or smaller, which we might will actually in an application I'll do at some point, we have to think about whether that's making our family of independent sets bigger or smaller. So if you add in more edges to H, you're making your family of independent sets smaller, and so it's easier to prove container theorems for them. So adding in more edges is going to make your theorem more true, but easier to prove. So, okay, if you want to do it, then it's still going to work. If you remove edges, it makes your family bigger, so it's hard to prove it, but if it's true, then it gives you a stronger conclusion. So. It will. Yes. Yes. So this is exactly why we'll at some point want to remove some edges from H, in order to make this true. Not in proving this, in applications. It can be useful to throw out some edges, so this is true, apply the result, and then you've actually bounded a bigger set. Okay, so let me draw a picture of this. So this version is slightly less precise than the version I stated last time, but hopefully it's slightly easier to understand. I took out these functions, which I think were a bit confusing. So, I suppose this is your world. I keep drawing the same picture. You've got some independent set. This just gives you some little set S inside, and some big set that's basically the whole thing. Right? We just shave off a little bit off the edge. And the point's going to be that this bit that we shave off we're going to know, so we need that I is contained in A union S. Right. So we have to know, given the information that we encode, that the set we encoded was S, we have to know that these red vertices are not in our independent set. Okay, there has to be enough information in order to throw out these red vertices. Okay, that's going to be the point. Okay. So I'd like to use the key lemma to imply it to prove the container version so you understand what the point of the key lemma is, and then we can start trying to prove it. I'd like everyone to be happy that it's a useful thing before we try and prove it. Okay, so the observation that we made last time was that these conditions hold for this hypergraph. So let me state the again the supersaturated Samarady theorem. Which we proved last week, just says that if A is subset of 1 to n with size of A at least delta times n, then A contains at least epsilon n squared k-term APs, right. Where epsilon depends on delta. So for all delta, there exists an epsilon. OK? So now I guess lemma, easy lemma. If A is a subset of N, size of A is at least delta N, then delta L of H restricted to A is at most C P to the L minus 1 E of H A over V of H A if C is bigger than 1 over epsilon or something. K squared over epsilon, I think we had last time. Okay. This was just an easy check that followed from the supersaturated Samarady theorem. Okay. This is where H is the hypergraph that encodes K-term APs. It's solved easily by looking at K-term APs, looking at what the degrees are, and using this result to get a bound on this number here, number of edges in HA. But this said exactly that if A is bigger than delta N, this number here is bigger than epsilon N squared. Right? And this thing is at most N. So this is at least epsilon times n. And P is this guy. So throughout today, okay, not throughout today, throughout this application, until I've proved the container theorem, this is what P is.
How did you compute the degree of
this? This guy? Uh-huh. That's basically trivial. You just look at, so it's at most what it is in the original hypergraph H. Yeah, so just trivially, it's at most that. And that's K-term APs, so you know what they look like. Every element is at most n of them. Every pair of elements is in a bounded number of them. At most k squared. So yeah, it's trivial to bound the left-hand side. The bound of the right-hand side comes from the supersaturated result. So this is very easy. Okay. Okay. So now, proof of container theorem. Container version of Samarady. Okay. So all we're going to do is apply the key lemma a whole bunch of times. Okay. So for each I, each independent set, we're going to find a container for it. This container has to have size at most delta times n. For each I in I of h, use the key lemma to find x containing I with size of x at most delta times n. And moreover, we get, because of this other property of the key lemma, this S, we're going to show that we didn't find too many of these sets X. They're just we do this for every independent set I, and we end up with only a small collection of sets X. Okay? So why is that? So what are the steps? Step one, okay, so let me give an algorithm. So let A0 be n. What am I going to do? So step one if the size of Sorry?
What is X?
I'm about to construct it. Okay. Okay, so at the start we have A is n. And then we repeat the following steps. So if A is smaller than delta times n, we stop. If not, we apply the lemma. And we get an S of I and an A of S. Okay. Step two. Maybe I should record what these things are called. What's the best way to write this? Okay, let me try and do it with a bit more space over here. Okay, we want is a sequence S1 up to S. What's a good name for a constant? T, that'll do. And a sequence of sets AI such that Sj are all smaller than this, c times p times n, and at is smaller than delta n. Okay. Those things are given by this lemma. Aj equals depends. Let's say AT depends only on S1 up to ST. Okay. Meaning that you can, given S1 up to ST, you can reconstruct AT. And the key lemma says that you can reconstruct A from S. Right? This is the fact in the key lemma, that if you're given the S given by the lemma, you know what the A is. That make sense? Okay. And how do we construct these things? So simply let, so apply, let me put it over here. Key lemma to H restricted to A, J. Right. Notice that I intersect AJ is an independent set in HAJ. Right? You have an independent set in H, and you restrict to a smaller part of the vertex set, you're still an independent set. You don't suddenly magically get some edges inside. Right? So we can apply this key lemma because we have the bound we want. And what does this give us? So we obtain sets SJ plus 1 and AJ plus 1. Right? Such that AJ plus 1 only depends on SJ plus 1, well, and the hypergraph we live in, right? So perhaps I should write that here. Make it really explicit. Okay. So that means that AJ plus 1 depends on AJ as well, but AJ only depended on S1 up to SJ minus 1. Right, so AJ plus 1 depends only on SJ and H AJ, but then H AJ depends only on S1 up to SJ minus 1. Because this is a subset of the vertex set. Yep, and the vertex set is AJ.
So,
yep.
What I guess you're trying to say is that so given SJ, you can find this AJ plus 1.
Uh-huh.
And, but it's not necessarily unique.
Sorry. Sorry, that's bad. Better. Sorry, say it again.
So, given SJ, you can find AJ, but it's not necessarily a unique set, it might be several of them, I guess. So, given your sequence of S's, you can find some sequence of A's, but it's not necessarily unique.
We are going to give an explicit construction when we prove the key lemma, which tells you how to construct this S and how to construct the corresponding A.
Okay. Yeah, but suppose it could be a different construction which gives a different A, but that's
yes.
Not important.
No, that's not important because we are giving a way of constructing it. Yeah. Yeah, we're going to tell you how to construct A given SH. Okay.
That's what you want to describe in this function.
Yeah, because that's the precise way to describe it.
Okay.
But it seemed that was confusing people, so I hope this is a bit easier. Yep. It's okay? Okay, good. Right. So we're almost done. We've constructed these things. So maybe I can erase. What can I erase? So we believe that these things exist. Is that right? just because of this. So, we just set x equal to 80. Right. So there's an x that depends on I. So, if you like, set C equal to the collection of x equals AT for all I in I of H. Thank you. Union, the union of the SJs. Yeah. We know they're not big because they're here. Right. So, x equal to AT union S1 union union ST. Fine. Whatever. So we're getting smaller by a factor of 1 minus delta each time. So after a constant number of steps will be smaller than delta times n. Just go another 1 over delta steps, whatever. Right, but they're all small.
Yeah.
Like really, really small. Because p is tiny, right? P is n to the 1 minus, n to the minus 1 over k minus 1. And yet, so each one of them has size little o n.
Okay, so
it's
not clear from the statement, but I assume that you say that this falls to a large n. Or when n is small, it might not
Because now it depends on how you use your... The fact that n is large, I mean, we've got a large constant here, right? So if n is smaller than this large constant, then the whole thing is trivial. So in fact, it works for all n. But yes, if you like, assume that n is sufficiently large. That's fine.
I'm worried
about the size of x. Size of x is the most delta n over 2 plus t times... C times P times N, right? Well, what's T? T is at most 1 over delta squared or something, right? So that's a constant. C is a constant. P is N to the minus 1 over K minus 1, which is little o 1. So it's smaller than delta times N. So this is at most delta times N. When n is large, fine. Yeah, so I mean, again, the capital C's are not all the same, so we can just take this capital C much bigger, and we will have to take it bigger than the capital C's over here. It's not going to be the same as this one. It's not going to be much bigger, but it'll be a bit bigger. I should probably say at some point that this capital C is it's polynomial in delta or something. It's not a terrible constant. Okay. So we set x equal to this guy. Let's come back over here then. Set C equal the collection of X, which depends on I, such that I is in I of H. Okay. So note that I is contained in X of I. Because of the way we defined it. Right? It's okay? So I this is what we just talked about, no? That by definition, I is contained in this guy. Right? Because of this. So we're doing it for a particular independent set. We find a particular set that contains it. Is it okay? No? Right. So each step of at each step, we had the I was contained in AJ union SJ. Right? So if we set A, yeah, so it's just a, I mean, yeah, is it okay? It's the way we constructed them, right? Sorry? No, I mean, from the lemma. This A is obviously contained in the vertices of H, and we applied it with the lemma equal to H restricted to AJ.
Ah, okay, sorry.
Right, so, yeah, we restrict our universe each step. Yep. Okay, so this is true. Size of xi is at most delta n. That's also true. We just proved it. Yep. So the only thing we have to do is count the size of c. How big is c? Well, remember that at depends only on s1 up to st. So if we choose S1 up to ST, that'll give us A. Right? How many choices are there for SJ? That's the product J equals 1 up to T of, well, how big are these sets? They all have size at most C times P times N. So let's just pick any set of this size. N choose C times P times N. Which is smaller than N to the C prime times P times N for some C prime large. Right, because T is a constant. Yeah, sorry. I mean, because today they're all, yeah, later they'll be different. But, yeah, today they're the same. So, whatever. Yeah, sorry. Later they'll be n choose 2, but today they're the same. Is it okay? Okay, so all we did, we applied the key lemma a bounded number of times. Our universe got smaller and smaller and smaller until it was size at most delta n. Then we stopped and we said, okay, we've found our container. We said, how many choices do you have at each step? Well, only the number of choices for this set S. Right? That was the number of different choices we could have made. Right, because if you deter the choice of A only depends on S, so once you've chosen S, you've chosen A. Right, and how many choices are there for S? Well, S is small, so not many.
So,
it's at most 1/(delta²), because each time we go down by a factor of 1 - delta, and we only have to get down to size delta times N. So after So it takes 1 over delta steps to go down by a factor of 2, roughly. So t will actually be 1 over delta times log 1 over delta. But whatever, constant. OK. And so that's a proof. That's it. OK. So essentially, all applications are going to be like this. You take your key lemma, you apply it a whole bunch of times. Notice that at each step, at each application, we needed to use our supersaturation theorem, right, in order to check the conditions. And as long as they held, we could keep shrinking and shrinking and shrinking and shrinking. And in this application, and in all applications that I'll do at first, we can choose the same P every time we apply the lemma. At some point, some applications will want to change, vary our P as we get smaller.
So this application, P wasn't really
a problem? No, I mean, it's a deterministic statement, right? That,
yeah.
That the whole thing, this container thing, is a deterministic statement. It's not a probability at all. It just turns out to be the probability that you can use in the sparse random version. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and you should probably think of it as being something like a probability. It's or like a density. Yeah. Right. Okay. That was an hour. OK, so I can start telling you about the proof of the key lemma, unless there are more questions. OK? So we believe that the key lemma is useful. In at least one case, yeah. Yeah. Right. OK, so let's try to prove the lemma. I think today I'm just going to try and prove it for 3 uniform and see how it goes. Yep.
The container version is that the interesting result, or is that the result that shows that containers are
important? The result that people cared about originally was the sparse random version. Actually, people cared about the counting result as well. It's very similar to something called the KLR conjecture, which is a more technical statement, which is useful in when applying the sparse semi-radio regularity lemma. So I guess people also cared about that, or similar statements for other reasons. And the container thing is just a thing that gets you the things that you're really interested in. But it's also nice, right? I mean, yeah. And I guess the other thing is that this also has other applications. Well, okay, not in this setting, but well, in later applications, then perhaps you'll agree that this is a nice kind of statement. Yeah, it makes applying Markov very easy. I mean, that's the main thing.
Okay. Yeah, but so when you're working with containers, what you really need also in different problems, then you need a K-lemma and some additional result that tells you that.
So you have the K-lemma.
Yes.
We're going to prove that in general.
Uh-huh.
But yes, you need a supersaturation theorem. So you can't do anything without a supersaturation theorem.
Okay.
And in many cases, you don't have that, and therefore you have to prove it yourself.
To prove this bound and the degree.
Exactly, exactly. To check these bounds and degrees. Exactly. Yep. Yep. Okay. Okay. Proof of key lemma. Let's say k equals 3. Okay. So, we're going to mimic the proof, sort of mimic the proof of the graph case. So, what we're going to do is order the vertices from left to right according to their maximum according to their degrees. So, we're going to pick guys who send many degrees forward. And then our algorithm is going to say, start at the left, go along till you find an element of I. Okay? And put him in S. And now you can throw out of A everybody to the left of him, right, because you looked at them and they're not in I. So if they're not in I, if you know they're not in I, just based on the things that are in S, right, then yeah. So you're given, you know the hypergraph, so you know the maximum degree order, and you're going to know what's in S. So you can repeat this process. You can look along, okay, go till you find the first guy in S. You can say everyone else was not in I, otherwise I would have put him in S. Okay. And who else can we throw out? Well, no one yet, but there's a whole bunch of pairs which are in a triple with V1. Right? So this pair now becomes a forbidden pair. If you think of the hypergraph as being forbidden triples, if you say I is not allowed to contain any of these triples, and you say V1 is in I, then you obtain a whole bunch of forbidden pairs. Right? You can't have both of those elements, because then you'd have a forbidden triple. Okay? So this guy goes into a hypergraph we're going to call H2. So the original graph is H3, which equals H, and we obtain a hypergraph H2. Okay. Yep. So I'm going to do everything precisely afterwards. So I just want to give a rough idea. But what we're going to do is we're going to identify some elements of I, and that's going to give us a hypergraph H2, a two-uniform hypergraph of forbidden pairs. So maybe I should write what H2 is. So H2, okay, this is not what H2 is, but it's a first attempt at H2. It's the collection of vertices UV in n choose 2, let me say v of h choose 2, obvious, such that there exists a w in s, such that u v w is an edge of h, so h3. This is the first thing you might try and make H2 be. Okay. Exactly. You're constructing S as you go along, but yeah, W who's already in S. So maybe I'll, yeah, so they're different S1s to those, so maybe I'll call it S3, because I'm constructing it going from 3 to 2. Okay, so we're going to pick a whole bunch of these elements of I and put them in S3, saying these guys are in S3, and they'll end up in S. And then H2 should be something like the collection of pairs such that there's a triple in H3 which is completed by an element of S3. Right? So note that. So the key observation, I is an independent set in H2. Right? Is that okay? That's the sort of the key thing. Right? Is it okay? In this graph here. Right? And why is that? So, okay. I'll set observation. Observation, I is in an independent set in H2. Why? If U, V are in I, and UV is an edge of H2, right? This is the other possible. If it's not true, then, well, if this is an edge of H2, by definition, there exists a W in S3, so UVW is in H3. But S3 is a subset of I, right? Because that's how we chose them. Yeah? We went along till we found something was an I, and then we put it in S3. Which implies U, V, and W are in I, but that's a contradiction, right? Because I is an independent set in H3. Okay.
So what is the rest of S3?
Oh, so I'm just going to repeat the process.
So at this point, S3 only contains one.
So fine. I've only put one in so far.
Okay. But it looks like H2 is dependent.
H2 just turns up. Okay. Yes. So let me define it. So algorithm. And actually, this won't be the exact algorithm because I'm going to save. Yeah, but there's an important complication, but let me give you the simpler version. Okay, so set H2 0 equals the empty set, and so maybe I'll leave this because there's going to be something else, but I'm not going to do it yet. If I equals 0 up to b minus 1, so for some b, do the following. So let u be... and I should set S3 equals empty set as well. Be the first I am gonna do it. Yes, sorry, yeah. They do mean different things. Yeah. Sorry, I made this notation up on the fly, and now I don't have anything to do with that one. okay, so we're going to start it with 0, and let's say the available vertices are everything. the available, sorry, edges is H3. At the beginning. And S3 is empty at this point. And then for I equals 0 to B minus 1, let's do the following. So let U be the first element of I in the max degree order on A2. Shall I call it A3? Yeah, sorry. It's three uniforms, let me call it A3. Sorry, A3 and H3 are three uniform hypergraphs. S is a set of vertices. And I just wanted to call it S3 because later on we're going to have others. So, would you rather called it subscript? It sounds like you'd prefer a subscript, so. But then it looks like a three uniform hypergraph, so it's better if it's a superscript, right? Okay, so A is going to be the set of, it's going to be kind of the available hypergraph. Sorry?
This is an algorithm.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was going to do with the superscript, and then you wouldn't let me.
You have brackets on it. Otherwise, I'd be very sure.
So that's what I was going to do here.
Big brackets. There's a bracket at the top. Brackets at the S.
I'm just going to get rid of that one. What, you want me to put, what do you mean big brackets? What are you talking about? Oh, for goodness sake, I have to do that, do I? Okay, fine, whatever. H20, A30, fine. Now you're happy. No, almost. Yeah, we didn't call it S superscript 3.
Oh.
Yeah. What did we call it? G0 or something. Yeah. Okay. So. So the first step, everything's fine. Right? Are we happy with what the max degree order is? Probably not. Yeah, so max degree order U1 is a vertex of max degree on A. U2 is a vertex of max degree in A. Vertex set minus U1, and so on. Okay, so uniquely defined.
What's it?
Uniquely defined?
No, it's just not what we necessarily
thought
it was.
Okay.
Right. It's not what I
thought. Right. U3 in A, B minus. I mean, yeah, so. Right, and so on. Yeah. Yeah. So it's useful because you know that the. Restricted to. Sorry, A is a hypergraph. So the max degree order on any hypergraph.
So this is not an abstract statement. A is a hypergraph.
Yeah. Yes. No. No. Yeah. Yeah, this is the max degree order on an arbitrary hypergraph. You might argue this is not uniquely defined. So fine, just pick an arbitrary order on the vertices, and in case of ties, use that order to break the ties. Okay? Okay. Okay, so we're going to do this repeatedly. So set S3 equal to S3 union U. You happy with that notation or not? So we're writing a computer program. Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Okay. Right. And what else? Then we're going to have to say what H2 is. Right. H2 of I plus 1 is going to be H2 of I union the things you need to add in. Exactly. UV such that VW such that UVW is an edge of H3. Oh, 3. H2, sorry. Sorry. Do we ever use anything other than the first element? We always just pick the first element of I.
Ah, I see. Never mind.
Yeah, sorry, on A3 of I. So we have to define what A3 of I plus 1 is as well. Yeah, it's A3 of I restricted to, we get to throw away everything to the left, right? And before you write, I mean, this isn't actually what it is. I'm totally cheating here, and we're going to modify this later, okay? This is a simplified version, just so we get our brains in vaguely the right position, okay? So let's call this set W of V1, okay? W of V1 is all the things before V1 in the max degree order. Okay? W of U J plus 1 equals U1 up to UJ. Okay? So it's going to be this. Are you going to allow me to write this? W of U. So I just mean I throw away all of the vertices that are to the left of U. Yes, I guess so. Yeah, why not? Let me throw it away as well. That's a good idea. Yeah, let me throw it away. Okay. And then just repeat this b times. Okay.
So you could be adding a vertex that's part of the edge of H2.
Yes. Except I'm not going to because for some other reason. I think. Mm. Well, when we modify it, we can think about whether we actually did that or not. Okay, so what properties do we want H2 to have? We're going to see what properties this gives, see they're not really what we want, and then we're going to modify the algorithm. Okay. So perhaps I can get rid of this. So what we want is, well, we want to throw away lots of elements, right? So I should probably say B is going to be roughly C times P times N, right? Obviously. Okay. What do we want? We want A to be not too big. We want to be able to throw away delta N vertices. So if these W's are all add up to a lot, we're already happy, right? So either sum over U in S3 of W of U is at least delta N. Okay. If that happens, then we're happy. Or if that's not the case, we'd like H2 to be a nice, big, thick, juicy hypergraph that we can work with, right? Because that's H2 is the only things that we know are forbidden are edges of H2. We're going to forget everything else we know, right? Or E of H2 big. And well, maybe in the graph case we're already happy. Yeah, I think this is why the three uniform is going to be easier. So maybe we don't want anything else. Yeah, okay, so it's not immediately obvious that we want anything else, right? When we did the graph case, what did we say? We just said, let's take a graph which has a certain average degree, and that's it, basically. So we want lots of edges. Okay, so perhaps we're going to come back to this when we deal with four uniform hypergraphs and realize that we're in trouble. Okay, so how can we show that E of H2 is big? If the sum of the W's is small. Well, do you remember the argument we had for graphs? No. The argument for graphs basically said, look at the guy that we pick. Suppose your average degree is D. Then either he sends epsilon D edges forward, or this set here has size epsilon D. That was just by counting edges. Okay. So maybe we can do something similar here. because H2 are the forbidden pairs, right? So in the next step, we're going to try and run basically the graph algorithm. We're going to try and run basically the same algorithm, get a set S2, and try and forbid lots of elements. If we don't have lots of forbidden edges, how are we going to forbid throwaway delta n vertices? Right? So H2 is all the information that we have about the forbidden pairs. Because the only thing we know is that S3 is in I. So the only edges, pairs we know are forbidden are in H2. So if H2 is small, we don't know anything. Right? No? So,
what this one colon statement is either we threw out enough stuff already
yep.
that we're happy,
mm-hmm.
or we have enough information left that we can toss out stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Right, so we want to toss out delta n vertices. If we've tossed out delta n already, we're happy. If not, we're going to have somehow to use this graph H2 to toss out a bunch more. And if H2 doesn't have many edges, it makes it very hard to toss things out. Right? Yeah, that we're going to use the edges of H2 to toss things out. What are we going to do? We're going to say, this vertex is an I, therefore we can toss out all of his neighbors in H2. Right? H2 is our, it's all the information that we have at this point, right? So it better have lots of edges. Well, or some other property that allows you to deduce you can toss that stuff out, but we're not going to be able to prove anything else. This is what we're going to have some chance of controlling. Okay? So, how can we show that H2 has many edges? Oh, we've run out of time. Okay, so homework. Figure out how we can show that H2 has many edges. Okay. Right. Okay. The H2 that we have at the end, so H2 of B. Is H2. Yeah. Yeah, and the clue is this max degree order, right? That if we didn't throw out lots of vertices in W's, then we picked a bunch of vertices that are off to the left of the max degree order, and we know we have lots of edges, so therefore we should be okay. Okay. Cool.